So you just created the best sculpture of your life in ZBrush. You want to render it out nicely, but you don't want to render it in Maya. You don't want to render it in Houdini. You don't want to buy Redshift. You want to do it for free. I totally get you. There is a solution in Blender and Cycles, and now I'm going to show you how to do it. Let's get our model out of ZBrush. I prefer to do it the old-fashioned way, through exporting the FBX file. I can then import the same FBX into any software that I want. Alright, now that we're in Blender, first of all, let's get rid of the default stuff in our scene. I'm now going to import the FBX. As you can see, it comes in rather large, so I'm going to join the plinth and statue together by selecting both of them and pressing Ctrl-J. Now I can scale them down and place them at the origin. I'll then zero out all of the transforms to keep things clean. Now let's duplicate our model a few times and rotate it around to show it off from multiple angles. I really like the copy and transform node in Houdini for this purpose. There isn't one in Blender, unfortunately, so I tried to recreate it with GeoNodes. If you want to replicate this, then here is my network tree. Otherwise, you can also do it manually by just copying and transforming and rotating your models how you like. Next, I'll model a simple infinity cove to mimic a real-life photography studio. It will give some environment for the models so they aren't just floating in space, and also it will give some secondary bounces for the lighting. And now, let's add camera from which we will render. You can snap it to the active viewport by pressing Ctrl, Alt, and 0 on the numpad. Let's lock it to the view. This way you can move it around the same way as we usually navigate the viewport. I like to increase the focal length a bit. I find that the values in the ranges between 50 and 80 are usually pretty good. Align the camera and tweak the infinity cove position and scale slightly so that it fills the frame. You can always unlock the camera from the view to return to the perspective view navigation for the tweaks. Press 0 on the numpad to jump back into the camera view. Let's have a look at setting up the materials. Let's switch to the materials tab and select our sculpture. There are two materials assigned. Let's remove these material slots and create some new materials. We will name the new materials too, so it's easier to find and identify them. I will name the background material m_background. And for the statue material, I will call it m_model. Cool, now let's switch to the shading tab and tweak the materials. I'm picking a different HDRI for the preview, not really a necessary step, just something for my visual pleasure. We will start by tweaking the base color of the background material. Let's make it darker. Now select the sculptures and tweak their material's base color. As we're going for a clay look, let's make it light brown. I will then tweak the roughness and IOR values. Higher IOR will increase the amount and intensity of the light reflected, and higher roughness will blur the reflection and spread the highlight more evenly across the model. We can make it more realistic by bringing in some textures. I will be using the same clay texture pack that I mentioned in the Houdini rendering video. It's a texture pack by Pablo Muñoz, and I will leave the link to it in the video's description. Press Ctrl-T to add texture coordinates and mapping nodes to control how our texture is mapped to the model. In order for this to work, you will need to make sure that you have the Node Wrangler add-on enabled in Blender. You can enable it by going to Edit, Preferences, Add-ons. Since our model doesn't have UVs, let's swap out the connection pins from the UVs to the object. We can change the projection type to box. This is equivalent to a triplanar node in Redshift. Next, I want to scale our texture down a bit. I will use scale X as a driver for scale Y and Z values so that I can scale the projection uniformly. Now I will copy the texture node and I will use that to plug in the normal map from the same set of textures into it. I will connect this node to the same mapping nodes as our diffuse map. This way we will know that it will match perfectly. Let's plug the color output of this texture node into the normal map node and connect the normal output to our material's corresponding slot. Make sure that the color space of the normal texture map is set to non-color for the normal map to function correctly. Let's duplicate the diffuse map texture node once again, connect it to the mapping node, and then load the roughness texture into it. Plug the alpha output into the roughness slot of the material and set the color space of this texture to be non-color as well. Looking pretty good. Now let's add another layer of sharper highlights to our material that will give a slightly wetter look to our clay material. We can do this by using the coating tab. Tweak the weight, roughness, and IOR values until you're happy with the look. First thing that we need to do is switch to our rendering tab. As you see, everything has turned black. Our shading tab is using HDRI lighting for previewing the materials in the viewport, but our scene doesn't actually have any lights set up for the rendering yet. No worries, let's fix that by adding an area light. Area lights are a good way to mimic the softbox lights of a photo studio. We'll treat this light as our key light. This will be the main one that will determine the look of our scene. I'll move this first light above the models, pointing it down at them, and crank up the intensity. Next, I'll scale it up a bit and experiment with the position. Remember, lighting is a big part of presenting our model. You want to accentuate the shapes and volumes of the sculpture. Now that I'm happy with how this looks, I will duplicate this light to create some fill lights to place on either side of our sculptures. I will move this one to the left, rotate it 90 degrees and scale it down a bit. Once I'm happy with the position, I will tweak the color and intensity of the light. And then I will duplicate this one and mirror it to the other side by moving it to the right and rotating it 180 degrees. I'll change the color of this one to something a bit warmer to balance the render out. I will also tweak the color in our key light. I like cooler temperature in my renders, so I will make this one bluish too. Now let's change our render engine from the real-time Eevee to Cycles. Cycles is a physically accurate render engine, and it's the one that we're using for the final image, so we will do all the fine-tuning in this. It takes a little bit longer to update and clean up the noise on the images, but you can see they're looking a bit nicer now. Quick rename and reorganizing of the lights in the outliner to keep the scene clean and easy to navigate. And now it's just time to play with the intensities, position and color values of each light to balance our image out. Have fun and find the look that you like. At this point, I decided to add an extra light to the scene, so I do that by copying the key light again and positioning it behind our models. This will be our rim light and it will give us some nice silhouette highlights. It's a bit too harsh at the moment, so I will reduce the intensity. Using the eye icon in the outliner to show or hide our lights, I can isolate each light and turn them on one by one to see the contribution they give to the scene and fine-tune them. The lighting is starting to look good, but now our background is looking a little bit distracting. So let's jump back into the shading tab and fine-tune the material of the background. I just want to make it more matte and also darker. It shouldn't distract from the models by standing out so much. Here we go. Back to balancing the light intensities for a bit, a slight camera reposition as well. Things are looking good. Let's just add some finishing touches. If you watched my Maya and Houdini rendering videos, you know that in Redshift I love using the curvature node to accentuate the details of the sculpt. As far as I could find, there is no such node in Cycles, so we'll work around that. Let's add the geometry node to our shader network. Temporarily, let's connect the pointiness of the surface to preview it in the render view. If you look closely, you may be able to see that it sort of acts like the curvature node, with crevices being shaded darker than convex areas. However, it's very subtle at the moment. So let's put it through a ramp and make the effect more noticeable. If you crank up the black value of the ramp, you will see the effect becoming more apparent. Play with the positions of the black and white ramp pins to achieve the results that you desire. You can now multiply the output of the ramp node by our color node and replug that combination back into the material's base color slot. A little bit more of fine-tuning to find a good balance. Let's also change the color in our ramp from pure black to a darker shade of brown instead. And the final thing I like to do is add some post effects to our renders. For that we go into the render tab, let's change the view transform to filmic and tweak our exposure and gamma. We can also use curves similar to Photoshop. Here we can change the white balance and make the image a bit punchier by changing the curve to an S shape. We can further play with the color correction through changing the curves of each individual channel. Embrace your creativity and play with the balancing of all these parameters until you find the look that you like. If you also notice something off in your material, now is a good time to fix it before the final render. Here I thought that the normal map looked a bit too strong, so I quickly reduced its intensity in our shading tab. And now let's do our final render. Hit F12 on your keyboard, or go to render menu and hit render image. Wait for the cycles to finish calculating all the samples, and there you go, your beautiful Blender render is ready to share with the world.